Today, we're gonna do what seems like a stupid comparison between two systems that may cost the same, but have wildly different use cases. It's gonna be kinda like comparing the IKEA chair I'm sitting in to a sex swing. Yes, they're both technically pieces of furniture which you can use to sit on, I guess. But it's important to know what the things are useful for so you don't accidentally buy a piece of BDSM equipment for a funeral or a song. In a recent video, I had a look at this absurdly powerful mini PC, which despite being the size of a hand fruit, really packs a whole lot of power in it. But it did get me thinking, how much more power can we get if we build our own system, not limited by this tiny footprint? So I decided to spec up a system prioritizing gaming performance, because that's the only thing I know how to do on a PC, and I adopted the age-old budget gaming PC strategy of cheaping out as much as possible on every other component to maximize my graphics card budget. Within reason, of course. But despite really cheaping out on a lot of the components, my graphics card budget was still in this weird no man's land where there aren't a lot of new enticing options on the market at the moment. But after ages of searching, Canada Computers came to the rescue with one hell of a deal on an RX 6600. It was such a good sale, in fact, it put us quite a bit under budget. And considering that I'd already bought all of the other components, and getting anything more powerful will cost us quite a lot more money, there's gonna be a bit of a price disparity between the two systems. But now that we have everything that we need, let's get to comparison number one, which is build effort. So to build the mini PC, you just kinda... Oh, that's not going well. Okay, see, there is a little bit of challenge involved. Okay, there we go. That time it worked. And just like that, we're done. Whereas getting the custom system up and running is a little bit more involved. Now, considering how I went about choosing all of these components, okay, so let's sort by lowest. Oh, this is a surprisingly powerful pile of stuff. But we'll have a closer look at the components as we get to them in the build. Ew, that is a disgusting rear I/O shield. Not only is it not integrated into the motherboard, it's not even a gamer color. Azrock, how dare you cheap out on this borderline irrelevant feature in what is the cheapest motherboard I could find on the market. Garbage now! Oh, that's quite a nice looking motherboard for the price, and it's got all the holes you could possibly want. A CPU hole, a graphics card hole, and even an M.2 hole. Now to cool our Ryzen 5 5500, which I still can't believe costs what it does, I'm just gonna use the conveniently included Wraith Stealth Cooler, which its installation process only requires medium crunches of death. RAM-wise, I got a 16GB 3200MHz kit, which is one DDR less and half the capacity of the RAM in the mini PC. But considering the graphics card deal, we easily could have gotten a 32GB kit. Ah yes, the well-known Moment MT34. I also bought half the storage capacity, but again, we could easily have gotten more. Okay, so now that we've got our core ready, it's time for us to have a look at the case that we're dropping this in, which, as always, is a Deepcool case. They really have cornered the market in affordable MATX cases that don't release flesh-eating bacteria into your house. I mean, that does look spiffy. Okay, so this is a dope feature. It's fit to hang your headphones on! And it, like, hides away. So now that we've undressed our awesome little Deepcool case, let's drop our Thermaltake power supply in there. 600 watts, ooh, fancy. Ooh, maybe fancy isn't the right word. Oh, that's a lot of cables we're gonna have to hide.
Oh yeah, come on, ah!
Oh, that went deep under my nail.
Oh, yeah, no, that's not great. That's because of all the smack talking I did earlier. Whoa, it's crazy how this motherboard manages to make this case look huge.
And after a bit more screwing and some cable management, there was just one thing left to do.
And now we just have our tiny boxed RX 6600 to drop in here, and then we have a pretty beefy gaming system. Aww, that's such a tiny, cute version of it. We've got some heartbeat action on the back, which I'm sure will get the medical professionals in the audience very excited. Its tiny stature does get me a bit worried about the temperatures though, but it's a 6600, not the most power-hungry GPU, so hopefully it's fine. And just like that, the slightly more complicated setup process of our custom system is finally done. Oh, and I also still had to install Windows on it. But after that, it was definitely done. Now, one of the biggest advantages of the blood sacrifice required to put together this system is upgradability. It is super modular, therefore super upgradable, and obviously it's gonna win against something like this. However, for what the mini PC is, it's no slouch when it comes to upgradability. You can easily get access to its insides through its bottom, and there's a bunch of stuff in there that isn't soldered down. So for what it is, it's not too bad. The rear I/O on the little mini PC is absurdly good compared to that of the system down here. There's a whole bunch of modern fast connectivity back here, and there's even more on this side. Look at that. Whereas the rear I/O down here would hardly have been impressive 10 years ago. Having said that, we do have a lot more video outs here due to our graphics card, so we can run 4 monitors if we want, something which would still be possible on the mini PC because of all the USB-C, I guess. So me cheaping out on the motherboard really cost this system dearly in this category. Whoa, you can easily fit like 9 of them in there and still have plenty of room under your TV. I mean, it kind of fits. Should have bought a smaller case. Now we've finally gotten to the category where the custom system can redeem itself, because I've kind of kneecapped it in a lot of ways so that it can dumpster the mini PC in gaming performance. Not all performance though, as we'll see soon, because the Ryzen 7 7840HS in that mini PC is no easy prey. But let's see to what extent the dumpstering is gonna happen. Now, GTA 5 at 1080p normal settings, i.e. low, is happening because of the mini PC, but on the full-sized PC, we're getting into the stutter zone here. It's running very smoothly at the moment, but that is gonna happen quite a lot. Our system is just too powerful for these settings. Which isn't a problem for the mini PC. With an average of about 120 frames per second, in GTA we get much better 1% lows because of the lack of stuttering. And for an iGPU, that's a lot of frames to be getting at 1080p. But the fight becomes much less fair when we crank up the settings. Oh damn, even at 1080p high, we're just skirting along the stutter zone here. This is about as high a consistent frame rate as you can get before the game engine starts having seizures. Whereas with the mini PC, we lose about half our frame rate, opening a massive gap in performance between the two systems. Esports be running real well. This is 1080p low settings, but we're comfortably getting over 200 frames per second. It feels really good, but it's not like it was running terribly on the mini PC. We're getting a surprisingly similar result between the two. Yeah, the gaming system's running better, but that's not a shabby result for our iGPU-laden mini PC. At 1080p low settings with epic draw distance, Fortnite is running very well. Like, you don't really need more performance than this, and it just feels great. In Fortnite, the gaming system really stretches its graphics muscle with double the frame rate we got with the mini PC. But again, the mini PC result is very playable at 1080p. On a quick side note, temperature-wise, the gaming system's doing fine. The graphics card tops out at just over 70 degrees Celsius while gaming, and it's as quiet as somebody with a phobia of confrontation having their place stolen in line. Whereas the mini PC actually has lower temperatures than the gaming system, which is kind of wild, but it's much more audible than the gaming system with a higher pitch whine. Oh, Oh, damn. At 1080p low settings, the RX 6600 is not phased by Cyberpunk at all. This gives us a lot of performance headroom to crank up the settings, because Cyberpunk doesn't look great at low settings, but we don't have to play at low settings with this system. And it's with these modern Visual Safari games where the mini PC really starts drowning, needing lifelines like Fidelity FX to get anywhere near playable results at 1080p low settings. In fact, the gaming system gives us a higher frame rate at 1080p high than the mini PC on low settings. And the story gets even worse with the next game. Oh yeah, I feel like 1080p low settings is a spit in the face of this gaming system. It wants more. But even at lowly low settings, the mini PC has had enough. And you have to crank Fidelity FX all the way up to Vasilino Vision to get a playable result on The Last of Us. So the mini PC may put up a valiant fight in esports titles, but in the land of Visual Safari, a proper graphics card is easily still king. However, when moving over to CPU benchmarks, the story very much changes. That 7840HS is a force to be reckoned with, easily curb stomping the desktop system. And on a final side note, because of the lack of encoder on the iGPU in the mini PC, you can't use AMD Adrenaline screen capture with it, which is a real pet peeve of mine and is something to keep in mind. And with that, what did we learn in today's video? Well, apparently tiny PCs are getting terrifyingly powerful, and who knows, maybe 10 years from now we'll all be gaming on PCs small enough that with enough effort can fit inside your person. And with that image, until the next one, bye bye. We'll be right back.